We will continue with sections 3.11 to and including 3.14 on groundwater. In an isotropic, unconfined aquifer, precipitation induced groundwater flow to a partially penetrating canal, a canal not incised to the top of a possibly lower-lying impermeable layer, occurs along curved pathways or streamlines. Also, a partially penetrating canal is in part recharged by groundwater from below, as also shown in this figure. These findings may be attributed to Dutch engineer Johan Penning, director of the Amsterdam Waterworks at the beginning of the 20th century, who monitored the hydraulic heads at different depths using a range of piezometers positioned perpendicular to drainage channels in the coastal dunes of the Netherlands. For steady flow in an isotropic medium, streamlines are perpendicular to equipotentials, shown as dashed lines in this figure. The water pressure at the position of the screen of a piezometer, expressed in meters water pressure, the pressure head, equals the length in meters of the column of water contained in that piezometer. This figure thus also shows that groundwater flow is from low to high pressure, from a high to a low elevation in the upper recharging part of a hill slope, and from a low to a high elevation, from high to low pressure in the lower discharging part of a hill slope. With a semi-permeable layer in the subsoil, streamlines between a recharge and seepage area are also curved. This figure shows recharged vertical groundwater flow through a horizontal semi-permeable layer being refracted in a horizontal direction after entering the lower aquifer and being refracted back to the vertical in its seepage trajectory after re-entering the semi-permeable layer. The hydraulic head in the lower aquifer is measured here and here, and the hydraulic head in the upper aquifer here and here. Please note that the potentiometric surfaces of the upper aquifer and lower aquifer cut each other here. This is the potentiometric surface for the lower aquifer, and this is the potentiometric surface for the upper aquifer. This takes us to the situation in the western part of the Netherlands, shown in cross-section here, a figure taken from Professor Codevries's book on the hydrology of the Netherlands, where low-lying polders made up of horizontal semi-permeable clay and peat layers lie on top of a horizontal sandy aquifer. Surface water is regularly pumped out of these polders to ensure that the connected groundwater levels in the polders remain at a near constant level below the land surface, as shown here. The deeper confined groundwater in the sandy aquifer is naturally recharged underground from higher locations in the Netherlands. The groundwater in the sandy aquifer is confined, and as a consequence, its potentiometric surface, which we see here, may be higher than the artificially maintained groundwater level of a polder, especially if that polder lies deep. This leads to upward seepage in deep polders, such as, for instance, polder Groot Meidrecht, shown in the middle of this figure, where the artificially maintained near constant groundwater level lies at 6 meters and 40 centimeters below mean sea level. Because of the continued replenishment or recharge by precipitation, in Dutch, aanvulling door de neerslag, the water table in an unconfined aquifer is at some scale related to the topography. Two major groundwater flow regimes can be distinguished, as shown in this figure. From piezometer readings, one can observe a topography-controlled water table, the upper figure A, where the water table closely follows the local topography as a subdued replica. Alternatively, with a recharge-controlled water table, the lower figure B, the water table does not follow the local topography, but does follow the regional topography. In other words, it follows the topography at a cruder scale. In the Netherlands, during my student days, so quite some time ago, the groundwater flow regime, which one is the correct one, was the cause of much debate. Later it turned out that both regimes can occur. Simplified from work by Hachima and others, the degree to which the shape of the water table is topography controlled or recharge controlled largely depends on the ratio of the recharge rate and the aquifer transmissivity. A high ratio, thus the recharge rate is relatively large, the aquifer's transmissivity is relatively small, is favorable for the establishment of a topography-controlled water table, the upper figure A, whereas a low ratio, the recharge rate is relatively small, the aquifer's transmissivity is relatively large, is favorable for the establishment of a recharge-controlled water table, the lower figure B. Thus, when the conditions are right, a relatively high ratio of the recharge rate over the aquifer's transmissivity, local, intermediate, and regional flow systems may develop in a drainage basin as shown here. The time of contact of groundwater with the subsoil influences the chemical composition of the groundwater. The groundwater's chemical composition at different locations may be established from a relatively simple to use chemistry toolkit in the field and is most useful in establishing the groundwater's origin and whether the groundwater at these locations and at a specific time is part of a local, intermediate, or regional flow system. The latter activity is part of hydrological systems analysis, an analysis of the close relationships between land use, groundwater recharge, vegetation patterns, groundwater flow systems, water quality, and surface water networks. After determining the chemical composition of the water, there are many ways to display the differences in water chemistry. As an example, this figure shows adapted stiff diagrams of the concentrations in milliequivalents per liter for stream and spring water of the Tolbach drainage basin near Halle in the Gutland of East Luxembourg. In the adapted stiff diagrams, the concentrations in milliequivalent per liter are given along the horizontal axis for the different cations and anions along the vertical axis. This forested drainage basin lies within the Luxembourg sandstone formation, which is the most important aquifer of Luxembourg, as 90% of its water supply is obtained from it. The figure shows the effect that manure dumping on arable land in the western part of the drainage basin had on the water quality of springs 2, 3, and 5. In 1983, large nitrate values can be seen here. The springs show high nitrate levels because of local water flow over a slightly tilting impermeable clay layer within the Luxembourg sandstone, directed away from the arable land. A nitrate level of 25 milligram per liter is the European norm not to be exceeded for drinking water. High nitrate levels in drinking water, in the order of 100 milligram per liter or more, are especially dangerous to babies. In the human body, nitrate is reduced to nitrite by the digestive system. Nitrite reacts with the oxygen-carrying blood protein oxyhemoglobin to form methemoglobin, which cannot carry oxygen. Sustained nourishment of babies using nitrate-polluted water may cause their skin to turn blue, the blue baby syndrome, indicating a shortage of oxygen in blood and brains, thus constituting a very serious threat to their health and life. Public awareness of the worst-case effects of drinking nitrate-polluted water may still be considered appropriate in certain areas. Fresh water from rain that falls on a dune on an island in sea causes the development of a freshwater hydraulic head HF relative to the mean sea level as shown in this figure. As the infiltrating and percolating fresh water replaces the saline water originally present below the surface, and as fresh water has a slightly lower density than saline water, a fresh water lens will develop that floats on the denser saline water. This figure shows the situation for an unconfined aquifer in an island with a precipitation surplus after equilibrium has been reached. A precipitation surplus means that precipitation exceeds evaporation on a yearly basis. This figure is for a large part comparable to what we will encounter along the Dutch coast. It is interesting to compute the depth of the freshwater lens as this provides a source of drinking water. Fresh water has a density rho f of 1,000 kg per cubic meter, whereas saline groundwater has a density rho s of 1,025 kg per cubic meter. If we assume hydrostatic conditions, no groundwater flow, at the interface of the fresh and saline water, a sharp interface and no mixing of the fresh and saline water, we can compute the depth of the freshwater lens HS relative to the mean sea level as follows. The hydraulic head equals the sum of the elevation head and pressure head. Now select a reference level where the elevation head equals zero anywhere along the interface of the fresh and saline groundwater. It doesn't matter where you select this. Once you have selected it, stick to it. Let's select the bottom of the freshwater lens as reference level. When the elevation head equals zero, the hydraulic head logically equals the pressure head. This is true for both the fresh and saline groundwater at the sharp interface. For the hydraulic head at the interface in fresh water, we can write this equation. Hydraulic head HS plus HF in the fresh water equals the pressure head in the fresh water, which we can rewrite as follows. Equally, for the hydraulic head at the interface in saline water, we can write this equation. Hydraulic head in the saline water equals the pressure head in the saline water, which we can rewrite as shown here. Physically, there can only be one pressure P at any point in the groundwater. Consequently, setting these equations equal and solving for HS delivers this equation. This relation is true at every location along the interface of the fresh and saline groundwater. It is known as the Ghijben-Herzberg relation after the Dutch engineer officer Ghijben and the German engineer Herzberg. If we take rho f equal to 1000 kilogram per cubic meter and rho s as 1025 kilogram per cubic meter, this equation reduces to this equation. Thus, the thickness or depth of a freshwater aquifer under hydrostatic equilibrium conditions, HS plus HF, equals approximately 41 times the convexity or differential head, HF. The convexity or differential head is defined as the difference in altitude between the top of the water table and the open water surface. The actual situation encountered below coastal dunes differs from the above, as hydrostatic conditions upon which the Ghijben-Herzberg relation is based in reality do not exist. Also, in reality, the interface between fresh and saline water is not sharp, since due to molecular diffusion, the interface will consist of a transition zone of brackish water, water that is intermediate to fresh and saline water. Nevertheless, the Ghijben-Herzberg relation offers a reasonably reliable quick estimate of the thickness or depth of the freshwater lands under the dunes that serves as an important source of drinking water. This figure is a geohydrological profile through the western part of the Netherlands showing the distribution of fresh, brackish, and saline water. Fresh groundwater can be seen to be found both below the coastal dunes and under a Pleistocene ice-pushed ridge some 50 kilometers to the east. Please take a look at the National Geographic Channel video Seconds from Disaster, Mountain Tsunami. The video can be found on the internet, and for the Geo 2, 4, 2 or 3 students, there is a link provided on Blackboard. Pay special attention to the one pizzometer that always gave a high water level reading. With this, we have come to the end of section 3.14 of my book. Geo 2, 4, 2 or 3 students, please make sure that you make the exercises. This also includes individual Blackboard exercises and optionally the Online Resource Center multiple choice questions of Chapter 3. Good luck!